Mark Dunn of Moda Fabrics. I could get really gushy about this comment, but I don't want to embarrass him too much. I got to know Mark Dunn both as a journalist source. I interviewed him frequently for magazines and articles and for my book, The Quilters Catalog, and as a fellow Book Alliance board member. Being one of the most powerful and creative people in the quilt world, you might expect Mark to be kind of macho and distant. Don't let the cowboy boots, or today, his electric blue Elvis shoes, fool you. Mark Dunn is likely the biggest angel that quilters have ever had. Not only has he made Moda Fabrics, which he founded in 1975, the premier company in quilt fabrics, with exciting designers and always a very high quality, but he's also a very giving and philanthropic person. And he does a lot for this organization. He's been a joy to serve with on the board. But he also has a lot of educational missions that he does. Anything that educates and inspires quilters and gets more people to know about our movement, he's there. One of the wonderful things that Moda Fabric does, and you may have noticed this in your local fabric store, they have a program called Quilts for a Cause. And year after year after year, they make a special collection of fabrics, and all the proceeds go to nonprofits. And they have helped lots and lots of causes this way. I'm really happy to say that he is helping the Quilt Alliance with the second collection for a cause he's done for us. And it's gorgeous. It's the Millwall series, circa 1852. Gorgeous stuff. Go look for it. We love it. Now, when Moda is looking for new ideas, vintage fabrics, and they're trying to figure out what to reproduce and what to get inspired by, one of the first places they look is in Mark Dunn's own fabulous collection of vintage and antique quilts. And his collection goes beyond that too. So Mark is going to share some of his treasured quilts, talk a little bit about the fabric business and how these things get translated. And I also just want to let you know that there's two handsome gentlemen with him. Brian and Josh are his sons, and they will be in the Walmart for adults and thank you so much. Thank you so much, Mark Dunn. You're a great man.
Nonprofit organization that keep it together. We have an office in Asheville, North Carolina, which is no bigger than this stage. So we aren't a big high profit that's spending lots of money on executives flying out, and most of the people that come to this pay their own way and give it their time and their service and their efforts to promote the industry and to help our cause. So we appreciate any donations. We have a little bucket up there if you want to throw a little money in. This is our main fundraiser for the year here, and we use the money to help fund our website and listed in the Library of Congress with thousands and thousands of quilts. If you want to search and find a quilt about Civil War or about early American quilts or about strap quilts or crazy quilts, you can just search on the website and bring up thousands of beautiful quilts that are historically preserved and preserved. So on the first page of the little booklet that I produced for you, it helps all this for you, maybe something for you to read on the way home or whatever. So, but our mission is to promote and educate, and particularly my mission as well is to educate people children, we work a lot of things with children's quilting. We have the exhibit over here where we have contests each year, make the small quilts and so forth. That's also a fundraiser for us. But, you know, my mission is to teach new kids how to sew and keep the craft going, art forms. It's a craft, it's also an art form. It documents our history, it documents our family, it documents our weddings, it documents lots of things that we all did in our lives and do in our lives. It's amazing to me that all you ladies and you, you gentlemen, out there, can do the geometry necessary to make these fine points and these beautiful quilts and artistic designs that you come up with. So I appreciate them, although I can't do them. All right. I can sew buttons on, I can put a zipper in. Unfortunately, zippers are not as popular as they were, so I don't know if I'm going to do it better. Anyway, it's a fun industry, and I have a mission too. This guy looks here, but I see a movement in our world, in our societies, and men are and women are kind of somewhat reversing roles in a lot of areas. And I think we can improve our business in this industry by 50% by getting the men involved.
Yeah.
So anyway, promote your dad and your husbands or whatever. Most of the men that I know that quilt are either surgeons who like to stitch and sew up their women. So here what you see here in front of you is several of my quilts from my quilt collection. I call myself an eclectic quilt collector. I don't call myself an antique quilt collector, although I do that and I love that. And it's part of what I love about quilting, because I like the history that goes behind it. And being a textile maker, I like the fact that, you know, you can, a good appraiser can look at a quilt and tell you just about the city was quilted, or the town, or the state was quilted, and the time period is a very short number of years, maybe 10 to 15, 20 years. They can narrow a quilt down and tell you just about where it was made, where the fabric was made, and so forth. So that helps document, and we like to reproduce those old textiles. So I travel the world to find old mill quilts, we call them, where these textile mills in France and Italy and America kept records of the styles that they made, and they sell these books that are usually sold like Christie's or some of these places. Some of them sell for $30,000, $40,000 a piece. They have little swatches of the design that was made in 1840 or something. So we buy these books, and then we pick out designs from them and design quilts around them. That's one of the things we do. Another thing is I find an old quilt that has beautiful fabrics in it, and sometimes we know the story behind the quilt, sometimes we don't, but we use that to make a quilt for a cause, or we can donate the funds to some organization. So we do two of those collections a year, and so I'm going to go through and kind of talk about a little of the quilts and which ones, why they came into my possession, and why we actually chose to reproduce, and the stories behind them. One of the things we're really keen on in our association is to get everybody to document your quilts. I see lots of quilts at quilt shows and so forth that women have spent years sometimes making, and there's no acknowledgement on the quilt as to who made it, where they made it, or why. But one of the things we really stress in our nonprofit is to put something on the back of the quilt to tell us a little about it. What most of these old quilts might have is maybe some initials that are woven into it with some embroidery blocks, or maybe a date that was woven into the edge of the quilt or on the side of the quilt or something. That's very, it's nice and it helps, but it's not as nice as putting something on the back that shows and tells more about the quilt and the reason why it was given to this particular wedding or this particular person or an honor of some person. A lot of the quilts are, you walk around afterwards sign. They didn't know how the sign of Quilt until sometime in the 18th century. They didn't have inks that would actually stay on the Quilt. But once they finally developed the inks, they started signing Quilts, and you'll see a lot of these were maybe someone in the family who died, or maybe people who had died in the family and their names were documented on the Quilt and so forth. Or a wedding Quilt where people were in the wedding, that type of thing. So that makes a Quilt more interesting, of course. Also, you'll see a lot of these Quilts here are in pretty bad condition. I don't buy a Quilt because it's in good condition, although I have some of these that have never been washed that are 150 years old. That's nice to find those. But that's not why I necessarily buy the Quilt. I buy the Quilt because it tells us a story, or maybe it has some other meaning behind it, and it can be in really bad shape, as this Quilt is here to my left, which if you look up close, you'll see many of the fabrics have deteriorated through the years. In the old days of making dyed stuffs, they couldn't make certain colors until certain periods of time. They didn't know how to make a color. They didn't know necessarily that the materials that they used were going to do damage to the quilt, or that the fabric would rot. Basically, they used a lot of browns and beiges in quilts because of the fact that they didn't have washing machines, and the quilts would show dirt more. And so even the dresses back then were made in very drab colors so that, you know, they wouldn't show dirt as much and didn't have to be washed as often. And those browns and beiges tended to rot quicker than certain other colors. Reds were bad for it and so forth. So it was years and years later until they developed the dye stuffs so that the fabric would not rot over a year, 100 years period or something like that. So it's interesting to look at it and see. They can be repaired, sure, but you'll be able to spot the repair work if you're a good appraiser. Yeah, so, you know, we choose not to repair them, but just to have the patina, so to speak, so you can see and document the fact that at that period, that particular color tended to rot. So, anyway, we're going to go through it a little bit here. So, we have a little brochure that's in your bag that tells all about it and everything that's up here. So, later on, if you want to read it on the way home or follow along, you're welcome to. But, first quilt is in my house, volume 2 to the left there. Very interesting quilt. This quilt is along the border, is the most important part, I guess. In the original quilt, the border shows the headshot of the princess and the whale and her fiance, the prince of Wales. The princess is Charlotte and the whale and her fiance. That was like the, you know, at that period, it was kind of like the William and Kate Middleton. But they were, you know, very special people in the English monarchy. And then she got pregnant and had a baby, and she died right after the complications of having a baby, and all of them went into mourning about her loss. So this quilt was made to kind of document her and to give it to somebody in the monarchy as a gift in honor of her. It's made with scallops. We made a kit, you'll see hanging there beside it. We made a kit with duplicating everything except the border. We couldn't quite do the border the same way because, it's a long explanation, but anyway, we have a border that's the same color and so forth. But we made a kit and we pre-cut all the little designs and all the little scallops. So that, you know, the woman didn't have to actually cut out 500 of them. We cut them out for them and put the kit together. And we went, you know, to stores and so forth. So it's amazing how the, you know, the new and the old quilt, if you just add 100 years to the one we made, it'll look just like that. Just to show you kind of what we try to do is re-document or re-establish these beautiful designs and beautiful fabric from, you know, many years ago. I always say that a beautiful print is a beautiful print is a beautiful print. It doesn't matter whether it's 500 years old or 5 days old. They always, you know, the beautiful print continue to be that way. So this is still a good one. Pink was another color that was an awful hard color to make, and it was, and they couldn't make pink quilts until late in the 1800s. And black, believe it or not, was a color that they couldn't make for a long, long time. So it was, you don't see black and yellow in quilts as much. Anyway, the next quilt here is over here on my right. It's the diamond quilt. And it's our community that we named it. Trying to remember who gave it to. Oh, yeah. Sorry. This is a current one we're shipping right now. This was created about a year ago. Libby Lehman, not many of you in this room know her. She's a very great. She's a lecturer, a writer, a quilt enthusiast, and one of the great people in our industry. And she had a brain hemorrhage about a year or so ago, and then had 24-hour care for almost the last year. And we donated the funds from this to her medical fund to help her with her treatment. We've kind of changed our emphasis on this program to helping more people in our industry rather than things like early on we did the Red Cross, you know, diabetes, Alzheimer's disease, wounded soldiers, whatever. And we find that the industry really has a lot of people who need help. A lot of our organizations in the industry need financial help as well as our organization here. So we kind of aimed our emphasis toward the industry rather than the world of nonprofits. Like I said, we also feel that the nonprofit we are associated with certainly means a lot more to them, and it's a lot more meaningful than donating money to some gigantic nonprofit that's been 60% of their fund money running the nonprofit. So we have a very low expense. Asheville, North Carolina is where we're based out of. If y'all haven't ever been there, you should go there. The biggest home in America is here. Annabelle State. He was born, and I did. I'm from North Carolina as well. So he also, Mr. Vanderbilt, built Grand Central Station down here for all the other train stations here. He donated that to the city, I believe. So quite a story for Vanderbilt. He also built all the trains in the country just about. So one of the richest families in the country. But quite a home there. So we work out there, and I recommend you go down there visit our little office if you want to. That's the largest home in America. It's quite a home. So I also recommend you should see the 9/11 exhibit. If you haven't had a chance to, while you're in town, or even if you did here, a lot of people sometimes live in the city and never get out to see their own special things. So they have a large quilt that's the size of this back wall here, just about, that's donated to the people, almost 3,000 people who were killed that day on the attack of 9/11. So it's quite a quilt. Our industry is well known for doing its, for being donating and for giving back to their communities, to the industry as a whole. We've done things like the $1 million pillowcase project, many of the wounded soldier projects around the country have been done to raise money for military people coming back. And I think everybody in this room has probably made a quilt at some time or another for someone else in your community or in some association you're trying to help out.
quilts help soothe pain and make, you know, everybody feel a little better. Everybody loves quilts, whether they're beautiful works of art or just a simple quilt that's made from, you know, scraps and not a real particularly great quilt, but it's clearly the fact it was given as a gift and, you know, brings warmth and happiness and all those good things to people who are in need or suffer. So, anyway, that's the Living Demon quilt there, and that's just now shipping. The next one. Next one is an Ohio Star quilt called Charity. This quilt was given to the donation to the Alzheimer's Association. We have a couple of people in our company who have family members who are suffering from Alzheimer's, so we did this for them. This is what they call, we call it today Cheddar, the color Cheddar, which is a modern name for it. Originally it was called something like, it was called chrome orange, originally it was called when it first came out. And that there was in a period between 1870 and 1890, this color was popular. So this is an old, you know, this kind of documents that period and so forth. But we have a reproduction of it right here. And they pretty much look the same, except this is 10, 12 scissors to the inch, and that's a chunk of it. Nobody's really makes quilts anymore. I just had a meeting in another meeting like this, and I asked the bride and groom. I said, everybody in this room that's really made a hand to this quilt, please raise their, in the last year, raise your hand. Okay. So really we're not as much quilters as we are sewers. But anyway, it's a fact that today you can make 6, 8, 10 quilts a year at a sewing machine, whereas maybe make 1 or 2 a year in your hand quilting. So anyway, that's our Cheddar quilt. So we reproduce the fabrics, try to do it almost exactly, and then we reproduce the pattern as well. Next quilt we're showing here is was the first one we did. We had an employee and a woman who covered the northern around the Bay Lakes and so forth. She was from Rockford, Illinois, and she was a great sales lady and died early of cancer at pretty early age. I think she was in the mid-40s or something. And so this quilt was donated, the funds was donated to her in honor of her, to her family. So it's a thing called a pinwheel quilt, and around 1830. Mary Taylor Paulton donated. She began the quilt in 1830 and completed it in 1846. Using chintz fabric as well. Here's the one we made. That was also a kit. Also, we made the cups back. This quilt is called Faith. It's an Italian quilt. Down here at the far end. Italian quilts are kind of popular for the Italian quilters. Yes?
Do you think the gentleman
could walk the quilt across? You know, the quilt on the other side? Thank you. So this is Italian quilt. They were popular between 1800 and 1830. This quilt is strange. It doesn't have any batting in it. It's just the front and the back. And we figure it might have been someone who just wanted for like a summer quilt or maybe a summer house. And then we want a lot of heavy program to do it. So I think I would have a little bag in there, and I'm going to put that in the morning, not the original one that we had back then. So this was for a soldier, the Marines called Salute America's Heroes, and the Marines coming back from the wars and so forth. We donated the funds for that, and also one of these quilts for them to hang at their museum. So. That's got that light pink fabric in it, which at that time was kind of unusual to have, about the time it was built, so that kind of makes it special as well. The one we're standing in front of now, the red and white quilt, is, we called it Friendship. We have the names for all our collections. And it was made around the 1840s. This is one of the ones I talked about where the ink came after they developed the ink that you could write on a quilt with that would wash away or dissolve or fade away in years. So that quilt that's hanging up there, the original one, got up close, you can see all the names of people that it was dedicated to. And then you see the one you're holding up, which is our interpretation of that quilt in a smaller size. One of these older quilts. All these older quilts are really big, you know. I don't know, they didn't have king size beds, so I don't know why they made themselves like that. But anyway, they were 120 by 120, so we never saw it smaller. You can see in the magazine that we give you there, you can see how the signature can be took out the ink. This was donated to Feeding America, which is, you know, for people that are hungry or whatever. Next quilt is one of my favorites, and it's kind of different. I like stitchery. I like machine embroidery work. I like needlework. It's on a quilt, it just gives more interest, more fun. And this was a wool quilt, which I'm going to show you right here. It's the heaviest quilt in my collection. It's wool on the back and on the front, and then all the stitchery too, it just adds weight to it, so it's a very, very heavy quilt. But it's just quite a combination of different little stories quilted in all of those ones. The color of crazy quilt, although a lot of people think of crazy quilts as being more crazy, this is very rectangular and kind of organized, but it's still considered a crazy quilt. But the crazy quilts are really made from Japanese kind of block, like poison day, I think that's called Chinese string quilt. Broken file work into the country as poverty and so forth, and we showed it at a World's Fair, and the quilters kind of took up that look and started making quilts. We have a member of our board who's a very famous crazy quilter here, which she's a crazy quilt king back here. So anyway, she does quite a lot of them. Anyway, that's kind of a fun quilt, and these were usually not put on the bed as much as they were kind of shown in a parlor or something to show the skills of the quilt maker, to show her stitching skills. So a lot of times quilts weren't really put on beds, they were made for other purposes, and this one was more of a parlor quilt, so to speak. The next one is kind of a fun little quilt that like I say, I buy things sometimes that are obscure and strange, but this is the leather patches. The old days they used to make there's quilts made out of cigarette silks, and all I've seen the cigarette packs, they would give you a little thing made of silk that maybe had pictures of presidents or maybe states of the union or whatever, and people collected these. Back when smoking was popular.
And they sewed them together and made quilts. This was the same kind of idea where they made little postcards out of leather, and you could address them and mail them in the mail. You can still do that today. A lot of people, like some of you I've seen who have badges that are made, who have crooked little badges from your shops. You can mail those in the mail today, or post office will take anything you'll use for, because they don't have enough business. So just send anything you can mail it. But anyway, they address them. And this, the story about this is in the book, and it tells about how a lot of these were mailed to one lady who lived in somewhere in Maryland or somewhere, I think.
And you the whole thing?
Anyway, her husband and mailed them to her, he was out of town or something. It's just kind of fun. You stitch them together and just stories here. You can see that black piece is really deteriorated along that quilt, the black piece down on the bottom right. But this quilt is, if you read about it in the book, but it's called a charm quilt. I suppose you know what charm quilt is. It's where you've got lots of different pieces of fabric and all the same, supposedly. And just different pieces of fabric where people collect them from their husbands' pajamas or kids' shirts or whatever, and sew together like a family kind of quilt. So this quilt was made by a girl who was she was 14 or 15 years old when she started this, and she was a very young quilter, and this is kind of a hard quilt to make, but anyway, she got spinal meningitis and died at 16 years old. And this quilt came with a lot of documentation, is what made it interesting. You've got to have a story of her with it. Copy of the town records where she was recorded as being a citizen in the area or something. So it really makes the quilt interesting. So she was just a young girl. Also in the back there, you can see what the way we document all our, even our old quilts. We take muslin and run it through a copier and write the story out. That everything we know about the quilt, and we run through a copier and have the story attached to the quilt always. And if we sell those, you can buy them in quilt stores and things, that the little sheets of muslin or whatever that's designed to go through your copier, and you can put a picture, take a picture, put it on there. You can use to type up the information about who donated the day to and why, and the little story. Makes it just interesting to grow up, and again, makes it grow a family heirloom. So always do that. And part of the thing we do as an organization is promote that and have those kits that we promote to document your growth. The Baltimore album, I guess, everybody knows what the Baltimore album quilts are. They're made from Baltimore. It's a big seaport, and a lot of quilting was kind of look of quilt began there, where it's just different stories in blocks, so to speak. So we don't have a duplicate of that one. It's just some of these we didn't make as a charity quilt. That's just part of my collection there. But you can see where it was paired a little bit with the birds there, kind of blue. I don't know why they chose blue. But it doesn't look like it's that originally, but. Anyway, there's a few other places where some pair of work has been done and done quite matching. The reds and greens today in the album quilt would be much more vibrant. They fade in time and so forth. So there's an infant close. You can see where it was signed and the lady that did it, the year she did it. Everything else is in that, I think it's in that heart. Those two blue birds are there. If you get up close, you can read that. the next quilt is a basket quilt here. This is 1920 to 30. It's not a really old quilt, but it's just a nice one. It's already been washed. It has a neutral background. And baskets were really a kind of a popular thing at that time. And they still are. They kind of apply, you know, something about the home and so forth, the flowers in them, and fruit and so forth. So just kind of a nice one, good quality one. Now we're going to get into more of the kind of modern quilts, guys. This one here, this first one is one I bought here at Cal from City Quilters Museum. She had a show here, this artist, and I really fell in love with this quilt and purchased it a few years ago from the City Quilter. And anyway, it's a Japanese lady, Noriko Endo, is her name. She's a living quilt builder until she was in her 60s. She's quite an artist in a lot of ways. But she kind of settled in with liking textiles or working with fabrics. And so this quilt has been unusual in that it's not like normal piece quilt where you cut out fabrics and so forth and sew them together. What this is basically lots of little strips of fabric where she cuts the fabric up into little bitty pieces. And there was a lady here in America that had a thing called skippets. Kind of the same idea. But basically, she paints with these little strips of fabric and laying a certain color down and then laying a piece of nylon net or tulle over the top of it to kind of hold them all in place. And then she stitches that down and then lays another layer of color or maybe the trees or something, darker colors. And then she lays another layer of nylon net on top and quilts again. And so she builds it up. And so if you look up close, you can see the layers of netting on top of the fabric. So it's quite a different method, but very unique and very, very special. And really gives it life and so forth. So she's quite a nice artist. Here again, she put her own vacuum on here. It's called Nature in New Zealand. It's the name of the quilt. Her book tells a quilt about all her types of quilt making. And she, she put this on herself. We took a picture of the quilt and put it on there. So that's the way how we store them, how we know what bag they go back in for storage and so forth. So, quite an interesting quilt. These next two quilts are some of my favorites. The one on the long skinny one. Pocket on the back here to keep all the information, and then
donated again from Southern Illinois. Yeah, probably interested in the floor. This is a lady from France here. This quilt hangs in my house. I collect her artwork. She's a very famous quilter. Very unusual stuff. A lot of machine embroidery work. All this is stitched right here. She uses unusual mediums like home decorator fabrics, bakery fabrics, and so forth. And she kind of works it all in together. She goes off the quilt sometimes with her work and so forth. But just unusual art quilt. And I have two or three of her works hanging in my house. So she's writing quite a good art quilt. This is called Josh's quilt. Josh, my youngest son. Here we sell a product called jelly rolls, which are little strips of fabric to get people started. You can start with quilting, make quilting fast and easy, or you can cut them up and do all kinds of different things with them. That we take one jelly roll, which has 40 different designs in it, and then you just sew them together, bound it, and put the back through the border. So he's got this little, I turned it back so you can see this little thing he made to show him sewing at a featherweight sewing machine. And it says, Merry Christmas 2012 to Dad from Wolf. Wolf is his nickname. Wolfie, when he was a baby, but now doesn't like to be called a wolf or something. The wolf got out of Mozart, he was in the womb, they called him Wolfie. So anyway,
this is that's a good example of a quilt that's not necessarily an artistic piece of work. It's just a beginning quilter who makes a gift for someone who has meaning and has a goal because he's a guy, first of all. And he's never done a sewing machine, secondly. Anyway, to me, it was a good, perfect gift to give me because I have most everything else I need in life. So anyway, that is fun, so I'm proud of that. And the other side of this. On the other side of this, Luke Haynes is here. Luke, stand up. He's on the board too, and with me and 30 other people that are here. So Luke is quite a quilter, and he does works in lots of portrait type quilting. My two big fabric suppliers, one will celebrate 20 years of working together and a good relationship, so they commissioned him to make this quilt, and he presented to me at a little party we had, a little gathering to celebrate our year working together. So anyway, I'm very proud of that too, and great advertising. But that's I think that's everything I'm going to show you here today. And just if you have any questions or something, I'm happy to answer. So, anybody out there has anything?
Sure.
Boxes and so forth. We don't like boxes, we're getting ready to change to a new system, which is why
still not the best way to store a farm equipment, you know. And so, like, if you go to Nebraska, where they have the agricultural studies group, you know, they have a system there, if you ever go to Lincoln, check out the Quilt Museum, and they have a fantastic system where trays, they pull out, dig trays, pull out, and quilts are stacked, like, 130 of them, and they're black. That's the way to go, they're black, they're like $50,000, you know, the whole 20 quilts, so, you know. You have to think about that. They need to keep rolling and rolling. But anyway, so that's kind of how we keep it. We have a lady who takes care of them, and she's kind of our, you know, our privacy.
Eventually, your reproductions will become antiques.
Eventually, what, I'm sorry?
Eventually, your reproductions will become antiques.
Yes.
If it weren't for the labels, how would you be able to tell them apart from the original? And how
just from the past? Well, first of all, you know, a historian can tell the difference right away. You know, build a story and just like they can tell the difference between a Van Gogh and a fake Van Gogh or something, I guess. But I don't know how that would work. I haven't thought that far ahead. But
the fabric, you know, the reproductive fabrics are just so amazing.
Yeah. Well, you can say that. I can tell the difference because they don't fade the same. Modern dyes are so much better, and the dye stuffs are not fade quite as bad, and the material and all that. So, you know, anything made after, you know, the last 50 years is going to be probably safe to go 200 or 300 years. I don't know if that answered your question, but anyone else? Yes, I did.
Great presentation. Thanks very much. What was it in 1974 when you say, hey, maybe next year I'm going to start something fully
found? Well, my father was in business.
Could you repeat the question, please? What was his question?
No, his question was something about what made me start my business in 1974. Is that what you said? Okay. I grew up in the business. My father was in it before me, not necessarily making fabric, but he was in the textile, I mean, in the industry. Back in the 1970s, I call it the world was about sewing clothing. It was about making dresses. It was about polyester double knits. And so that's how I learned to put a zipper in. And so, you know, we started out, I started out selling notions, buttons, ribbons, threads, all the stuff you make clothing with. And then in 76, the world kind of started changing. The home sewing began to die because they didn't pick up home ec in the schools. Nobody, the schools couldn't afford to get the supplies or they didn't buy the machines or whatever. So sewing, you could see it on the horizon was going to be shrinking. And quilting was starting to really emerge because of the bicentennial. And you know, everybody started to do things about that. And the resurgence of our industry, the Renaissance, I call it the industry, started about that time. The quilt market started about that time. And then, you know, we'd go around telling stores, you know, you have a quilt store in your store. You just don't know, you can't see it. Just like you have a sewing store in your quilt shop now, but you don't see. You know, it's just a matter of, it's just fabric, and it's just things you make with it. You can make quilts, which is the best thing, because it uses the most fabric. Don't make doll clothes.
We told the stores to get all your cotton goods together, you know, put all your quilting supplies back there by themselves, add a few rulers and a few books, and you got a quilt store behind your fabric store. And that's where it kind of started and from there communicated. So I have a lot of double knits and all that sewing stuff that was not really good at that time. And you know, now the world is flipping over the other way, and the younger kids are wanting to make clothes. John was sewing, and they were eventually mutated into quilters. But I wanted to quilt for sure, because like I say, it's 14 yards of fabric, because they probably could win. I'm in the dollar business. Everyone in this room that has a quilt shop is in the dollar business too, so you just want to keep your store running. So I get those men sewing, get those kids sewing, and, help the users. Anyone else? Okay, someone? Okay.
How did you come up with the name Moda?
How did I come up with the name Moda? Well, Moda means fashion in Italian and French. And it's simple, it's easy to spell. I'm not a great speller. And, so I named it after it because it was, short. And in fact, even our name is not capitalized, it's just a lowercase. It's so, kind of under the radar and kind of simple. But it means fashion. If you go to Spain or France, you'll see lots of stores calling all that. More designers working up their shirt lines calling all that. It's a common name in the fashion. Yes?
Your collections, do you have the old ones still available, or do they stop, or do you stop making them available when you bring a new one out?
The question is, do I...
The reproduction of kids calling for a cause?
Yes.
You bring a new one out every year. Does the old one stop being available?
Yes.
Right.
Yes, the world of... I compare the world of quilting today as just like Hollywood movies. We hype them up for 3 months before they come out. The blogs, the marketing, the advertising. It comes out by the time it's in the stores for 2-3 months, it's on to something else. It's like a movie. How long does Spider-Man 2 stay out before it hits the video and the motel room and everything else? So our business today has evolved to where it's that fast and the lines just keep going. We have a few lines that are basic that do reproduce. My daughter is also a designer for the company. We have 30 designers, of which none of them are represented here. We have 30 people like you, so to speak, but we don't represent any of them here because it's kind of like, which wife do you give credit to? The other 29 are mad as well.
Book 1852 collection for
start spreading the news. I'm leaving today. I want to be a part of it. New York,